Welcome to A Look Ahead. We're delighted that you've decided to join us. You probably know by now that we study the Sabbath School lessons as prepared by the Seventh-day Adventist Church. And this particular series is for the third quarter, that would be July, August, and September of 2015. It's entitled Biblical Missionaries. Now, do you know who would that be? Well, we're going to talk about a very unusual one called the Unlikely Missionary today. And this is lesson number 3 in that series for July 18 of 2015. I hope you have your Bible handy, because we're going to be doing quite a bit of looking at Scripture, especially along about 2 Kings 2 and a little bit following there. But even if you don't have your Bible, we'd like to ask you to bow your heads with us and pray as we begin. Our loving Father, we thank you so much for the privilege we have of reading your Word, seeking to understand it and getting to know you better. Be with us now as we consider this interesting story from the Old Testament, what we might learn from it, and may we gather much. May those who listen gather much is our prayer in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, this lesson focuses on the story of a young Jewish girl, ended up being a slave to a Syrian military commander by the name of Naaman. Now, you should recognize that name if you've had some experience with Scripture. Just a little bit of historical background. Elisha's ministry lasted from about 850 BC to around 800 BC, and maybe a little bit later than that. There are 3 times in biblical history, interestingly enough, when a lot of miracles took place. And the question I want you to think about now is, why do so many miracles happen at these times? The first time was the days of the Exodus. Think of all the plagues and so forth. Second one, the days of Elijah and Elisha. And the third one, the days of Jesus and his disciples. So what do you think was unusual about those times that meant, that led God to initiate a lot of miracles? That's our first question.
Well, just getting the Israelites out of Egypt was full of miracles, the plagues and Moses' rod and the serpent and all that.
So you would say that on that occasion it was necessity to try to get them out of Egypt?
Yeah, Pharaoh wasn't having any part of it.
Okay.
I don't think it was just for Pharaoh, though. It was for the people that had been enslaved for, you know, they didn't know who God was anymore.
Okay. And the days of Jesus?
They thought they knew who God was.
Okay. Well, here's the question. Let me put it in a little different, a little more detail now. If you watch TV on Sunday mornings, you will hear people saying, if we just had more faith, there would be more miracles. Were these 3 times times of great faith or times of little faith?
Little faith.
Little faith?
Hard to tell. How can you tell?
Well, did you think there was a lot of faith as they were preparing to for the Exodus?
It was for Moses. He didn't want any part of it. God was getting through to him, and Moses had to be talked to by God. Mm-hmm. And
I think their culture is very different back then too. I mean, you can't really. Compare it with us right now, we're very materialistic. Back then, people were, even everybody was more spiritual in a way. I think they were just more confused about the facts of the spirituality that, because you had, tells in the Bible, these magicians could do things. We say, you know, they had the sleight of hand and all that, but who knows? There's angels, evil angels, there's the devil, and all that stuff kind of happens together.
Well, I'd like to suggest that if you look at it carefully, the background, I'm not talking about the few characters that stand out as the leaders. I'm not talking about Moses and Elijah and Elisha and Jesus, but the surrounding circumstances These were times of very little real faith. So it seemed like God tends to produce more miracles when there's more need of help, when people really are desperate for some guidance and some action and something like that. Well, look at our verse, first verse we want to look at for this particular lesson. It's found in 2 Kings 5 and the first verse. And let me get it up here to size. Naaman, the commander of the Syrian army, was highly respected and esteemed by the king of Syria because through Naaman, the Lord had given victory to the Syrian forces. He was a great soldier, but he suffered from a dreaded skin disease.
Wow, did you say through the Lord, through Yahweh,
yeah,
he gave Syria victory over Israel?
And it's interesting.
Is that what it says?
Yes. That's what my Bible says. Well, this verse contains no fewer than four descriptions of titles that put Naaman at the top echelon of Syrian or Aramean society. He exerted major influence on the king of Aram, or how you choose to pronounce that. That's another word for Syria. He was held in high esteem. He was the king's right-hand man in religious as well as military matters, and he was also extremely wealthy. So this is a man who, from a enemy society, had a young Jewish girl who had been captured in some kind of a raid. We don't know the details of that, but she was now a slave working for Naaman's wife. And of course, Naaman's problem was what?
Leprosy.
The dreaded skin disease. What do we know about leprosy, just as a little side note?
It's an infectious disease.
It's an infectious disease caused by an acid-fast bacteria. But in general, you have to be in a repeated contact with someone who has the disease. And the younger, the more likely you are to catch it. But basically, if you're past the age of 20, it's almost impossible. It's possible, but almost impossible to catch leprosy after you're 20 years old.
Really?
Yes.
Oh, I thought the older people were more susceptible.
Interesting. So, in ancient times, how did they feel about these people who had leprosy?
They were shunned.
Unclean, they considered.
Not only that, they were required. If you had leprosy, if anyone came within a certain distance of you, you were required to say, unclean, unclean.
Was that a good idea?
Well, it was a way to try to prevent spreading a disease.
Yeah. Did it work?
Well,
might have worked some.
They have minimized the problem to some extent.
Well, look at some examples from the New Testament. Look at Mark 1, verses 40 to 45. A man suffering from a dreaded skin disease came to Jesus, knelt down, and begged him for help. If you want to, he said, you can make me clean. Jesus was filled with pity and stretched out his hand and touched him. I do want to, he answered, be clean. At once the disease left the man and he was clean. Then Jesus spoke sternly to him and sent him away at once, after saying to him, listen, don't tell anyone about this. I'm going to ask you about that in a moment. But go straight to the priest and let him examine you. Then in order to prove to everyone that you are cured, offer the sacrifice that Moses ordered. But the man went away and began to spread the news everywhere. Indeed, he talked so much that Jesus could not go into a town publicly. Instead, he stayed out in lonely places, and people came to him from everywhere.
Did they come to him for the right reason?
Well, and why would Jesus tell him not to say anything?
For that very reason, probably.
Because Jesus' mission wasn't to heal the lepers. It was to heal the...
sinners.
The broken hearts, the misconceptions about God.
Yeah.
Well, if that's true, then why did he just say, no, I'm not going to do it?
Because he had compassion on the people.
Yeah, exactly.
Well, then that mission where he's only supposed to heal the brokenhearted may not... was dead in the water in the first place because he has compassion.
Well, there's a couple of other stories that are included in our discussion here, just to by comparison. You remember the story about Jairus and his daughter? A man named Jairus arrived. He was now Jesus had just arrived back on at Capernaum from having been on the other side of the Galilee. Man arrived Jairus. He was an official in the local synagogue. What does that mean? He's the big man in town, right? He threw himself down at Jesus' feet and begged him to go to his home because his only daughter, who was 12 years old, was dying. I mean, here's a case where someone who, under normal circumstances, probably would have not talked to Jesus, came running to Jesus. And why did he come running to Jesus?
Desperate.
He's desperate. He recognizes there's only one possible person who can help him under these circumstances, and he's there, and he's down on his knees begging. As Jesus went along, the people were crowding him from every side, and there's another miracle that happens. But drop down to verse 49. While Jesus was saying this, a messenger came from the official's house. Your daughter has died, he told Jesus. Don't bother the teacher any longer. But Jesus heard it and said to Jairus, don't be afraid, only believe and she will be well. When he arrived at the house, he would not let anyone go in with him except Peter, John, and James, and the child's father and mother. Everyone there was crying and mourning for the child. Jesus said, don't cry. The child is not dead. She's only sleeping. And they all laughed at him because they knew that she was dead. But Jesus took her by the hand, called out, get up, my child. Her life returned, and she got up at once, and Jesus ordered them to give her something to eat. Her parents were astounded, but Jesus commanded them not to tell anyone what had happened. And how long is that going to last? The girl goes running outside, and you say, oh, I'm sorry. Why would Jesus say those things?
Well, how about this? Jesus is showing them that when they've got good news, they can't hold it in.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
So he's telling them not to do it, scolding them even not to do it, but they do it anyway.
It's human nature.
Human nature, okay.
Well, you keep saying that when you have good news, you don't keep it in. So isn't that what's happening here?
Yeah. So going back to Naaman's time, which is our primary story, it's a well-known fact sociologically that when there is a major disruption in someone's life, she or he is more ready to accept new ideas, even complete new paradigms. Is that why the Christian church down through history has grown more rapidly and more successfully at times when there's a lot of persecution? Why is it, you know the famous saying, why is it that the blood of the martyrs is the seed of the church? Why is that?
When times are easy, people think they have need of nothing.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Kind of like Laodicea.
Okay, in light of that, try to imagine yourself in Naaman's shoes. On the one hand, you've got everything materially that you could possibly ask for, but you have a dreaded skin disease. So let's go back to 2 Kings 5 again, pick up our story. We'll start from verse 2 because we already read verse 1. In one of their raids against Israel, the Syrians had carried off a little Israelite girl who became a servant of Naaman's wife. One day she said to her mistress, I wish that my master could go to the prophet who lives in Samaria. He would cure him of his disease. I want you to think about this for a minute. How did she know that? I mean, think about the issues. First of all, he was a Syrian. How did she know that Elisha would even heal a Syrian? Two, had she ever seen him actually heal leprosy? How did she know whether he could heal leprosy?
I'm guessing she had seen it.
Yeah, or heard of it.
You don't think it's possible?
Even as a child.
That she had seen it?
No, that how would she know?
Well, if you're a slave,
yeah,
you don't go spouting off about something you're just guessing about.
So you're saying this in itself is pretty incredible.
Yes.
Yeah. I agree.
Yeah. So she says it to Naaman's wife, and of course Naaman's wife says it to him, and he's going, huh? Mm-hmm. Right? Had he ever heard of anyone who could heal leprosy? How many other people are around who could heal leprosy? Zero, right? So this was shocking news. Too good to be true, really. So what happened? When Naaman heard of this, he went to the king. Now this would be the king of what?
Syria.
Syria. And told him what the girl had said. The king said, go to the king of Israel and take this letter to him. So what happens? So Naaman set out, taking 30,000 pieces of silver and 6,000 pieces of gold and 10 changes of fine clothes.
How much is that?
That is a lot of money.
Is it one piece of silver is a man's day's wage?
Yes.
So in today's dollars,
that's
over $100 probably.
That's 100 months. What is that? 12 years worth of labor at least. 12 years worth of labor for an ordinary laboring person. And 6,000 pieces of gold, I'm sure, is worth even more.
Not to mention the weight, how he had to carry it.
Yeah.
He probably had a bunch of soldiers as guards.
So this letter will...
Had a Brinks truck.
What?
Had a Brinks truck.
Yeah, exactly. This letter will introduce my officer, Naaman. I want you to cure him of his disease.
The thing that I've wondered here is... We've always heard it as leprosy.
Mm-hmm.
Is that really what the original said? I mean, it could be other skin diseases. We've got psoriasis. You see a good attack of that, you don't want to get too close.
Yeah.
I mean, it's just a normal thing.
Yeah.
The other thing that's really incredible about this story is, why did Naaman even believe the girl?
Yeah, well, that's my question.
Yeah, yeah.
And probably the answer is, there's no place else you can go for a cure. What do you have to lose?
Exactly. Well, a prophet in his rank, he had a lot to lose if he didn't get something done.
Yeah, yeah.
What he had to lose was 30,000 pieces of silver and 6,000 pieces of gold.
Yeah.
That's nothing compared to getting healed, Paul.
Oh.
Well, so now he arrives at the king of Israel's place, and what does he hands him the letter, and it says, please, imagine today, go to the president's, you go to the White House and hand him a letter saying, please heal me of my leprosy. When the king of Israel read the letter, he tore his clothes in dismay and exclaimed, how can the king of Syria expect me to cure this man? Now, what do we know about the king of Israel in those days?
Period of bad kings, really bad.
If you look at the kings of the northern kingdom of Israel, they went from bad to worse to worse to worse. There was not a single one of them that was good. Until finally they were overrun by the Assyrians.
Yeah.
The Assyrians, actually, in this case.
Well, what's happening, it looks like God is setting things up so that this man of God is going to get the king out of a jam.
Mm-hmm. Well, so the king says, does he think that I'm God with the power of life and death? It's plain that he's trying to start a quarrel with me. So he thinks, what's happening?
Setting him up for war.
He's trying to get ready to attack Israel again. When the prophet Elisha heard what had happened, he sent word to the king, why are you so upset? Send the man to me and I'll show him that there is a prophet in Israel. Now think about this for a moment. Elisha had even heard about this story?
An angel.
Yeah.
An angel? Knew, told him that.
Yes. I'm suspicious.
That's a good answer.
I don't think this was going around. Well, maybe it was going around the countryside, but I doubt that the king would want it to be known that he's being set up.
Well, you know, I spent many years living in Africa. If you go to a rural village in Africa, and even if you drive a car in, because there aren't basically no cars there, every kid in the town is out there.
Bush Telegraph.
So what happens when a guy shows up who's a Syrian, the head of the army, dressed in fine, really fine clothes, probably riding in a chariot with a whole bunch of horses and guys, a retinue with him, carrying bags of they don't know what? What happens?
Attracts a lot of attention.
it attracts a lot of attention. Now, I don't know about all the adults, but I can guarantee you all the kids that knew about it were there to see it. This was a big event, probably of the month, of the year, or the who knows what. So, notice these interesting statements by Ellen White. The conduct, well, let me just ask a question first. Why do you think the family, Naaman's family, took this little girl's suggestion seriously?
I think she did good work. She was different from her background. She probably had some different customs and stuff. Ate differently, probably.
Mm-hmm. Well, Prophets of Kings, page 245, paragraph 1. The conduct of the captive maid, Carrie, that's what you're talking about. Yeah. The way that she bore herself in that heathen home is a strong witness to the power of early home training. That's an interesting thing. What does that point us to? Well, that points me to a pamphlet, 123, that Ellen White wrote. And it says this: the most powerful sermon that can be given the unbelieving world and recommendation of our faith is a well-disciplined family. Children that are educated to habits of self-denial and self-control and are taught to be courteous, kind, and affectionate will make an impression upon minds that nothing else can. Wow.
When you think about it, even in our times of lawlessness, any family, doesn't matter whether it's one of us or other Christian people or even non-Christians that have kids that are well brought up, it's a statement you never forget.
Well, let me give you an example. I just returned from an 8-day trip to Washington, D.C. And I went with a group of 30 eighth graders. Okay. Now, this is from an Adventist academy. So the every eighth grader has to be under the direct supervision of a supervisor, in most cases a father or a mother, maybe sometimes not always, but most of the cases. And the hotels back there were in Tacoma Park fight over the privilege of, so there was 60 of us all together because there's chaperones as well as students. They fight over the privilege of having us come and stay in their hotel because our kids who come there every year well-behaved, well-disciplined, well-supervised, and it's a piece of cake for the hotel. Mm. So that's another example. Of course, we know nothing about the childhood or training of this young Hebrew girl, but like the training of Moses in his first 12 years, her parents must have done a good job. So try to imagine now, here's this retinue, okay, this whatever you choose to call it. I don't know whether Naaman was riding in the front or he was riding in the back, but probably horses or donkeys, mules maybe, carrying sacks of money. People hopefully didn't know what was in there. Fine clothes, probably lots of servants to protect him. And he's traveling across an enemy border into a new land. Well, in an enemy land. And down to Samaria. That's quite a distance. What would you think if you saw him coming? Is it a military campaign or what?
Be worried.
So, coming back to Elisha now, while you're thinking about that, coming back to Elisha, what was Elisha's main job?
He led out the schools of the prophets.
He was in charge of the schools of the prophets. By Elisha's time, there were like 5 or 6 of them.
Yeah.
So at this point in time, he must have been at the one that was in Samaria. And he was basically trying to reform the nation by educating some key young people. That's what he was trying to do, really.
Is he the teacher or the administrator or both?
Probably some of both. I'm sure when he was there, he was probably the teacher. In general, he was probably the administrator. Who started the schools of the prophets?
Samuel.
Okay. So, thinking just a little bit about the background as we're trying to pull all the pieces of this story together, what precursor was there in the story of Elisha? What happened before Elisha?
Elijah.
Okay, very good. What do we know about their relationship and what happened?
I think it was a good relationship, and when Elijah left, Elisha asked God for a double portion of Elisha's.
You remember that story? Let's turn back to 2 Kings 2, I believe it is again. I can get my machine to take into action and go into action here. Come on. Okay, try one more time. The time came for the Lord to take Elijah up to heaven in a whirlwind. Elijah and Elisha set out from Gilgal. Now, that's one of the schools of the prophets. And on the way, Elijah said to Elisha, "Now stay here. Let the Lord has ordered me to go to Bethel." That's another school of the prophets. But Elisha answered, "I swear by my loyalty to the living Lord and to you that I will not leave you." So they went on to Bethel. So now they're both at the next school of prophets. A group of prophets who lived there went to Elisha and asked him, "Do you know that the Lord is going to take your master away from you today?" Now, what does this tell you? Now, remember that this is a time when Israel is led by a very wicked king, and most of the people were probably involved in a lot of wicked activities. And what's happening here?
Uh-oh.
Sorry.
And you were saying?
What's happening here?
Well, it's obvious that there are some believers, a group of them at least.
But what these students at the School of the Prophets know what's going to happen that day in advance.
Well, they're prophets.
Well, that's my question. What I mean, can you go to a school and become a prophet?
Well, there could have been some other older people there we don't know about.
You don't think a young person could
be
a prophet?
Well, I'm not saying that. But it's obvious that Elisha was backpedaling on this whole thing, but when it finally happened, he wanted a double portion of Elijah's spirit, I think the word was.
Yeah, okay. So what happened then? Elijah said to Elisha, "Now stay here, the Lord has ordered me to go to Jericho," another school of the prophets. But Elisha answered, "I swear by my loyalty to the living Lord and to you that I will not leave you." So they went on to Jericho. A group of prophets who lived there went to Elisha and asked him, "Do you know that the Lord is going to take your master away from you today?"
So how close are these cities? These aren't five one
miles,
day walking distance, are
five
they?
5 miles, 10 miles, just 5 or 10. Okay. Yeah.
How
now Samaria? No, we don't know that it was in Samaria. From Gilgal, yes, Gilgal to Bethel to Jericho is a few miles.
Okay. I can understand how these people would know that Elijah is going to be taken, but how do they know it's today?
Yeah.
Day. Well, the day that they're talking.
Yeah. Then Elijah said to Elisha, "Stay here. Now stay here. The Lord has ordered me to go to the River Jordan." But Elisha answered, "I swear by my loyalty to the living Lord and to you that I will not leave you." So they went on, and 50 of the prophets followed them to the Jordan. Now notice here, they're actually called prophets.
Well, mine has it 50 men of the sons of the prophets.
50 men of the sons of the prophets, okay. Followed them to the Jordan. Elijah and Elisha stopped by the river, and the 50 prophets stood a short distance away. Then Elijah took off his cloak, rolled it up, and struck the water with it. The water divided, and he and Elisha crossed to the other side on dry ground. I mean, imagine even watching that. There Elijah said to Elisha, "Tell me what you want me to do for you before I am taken away. Let me receive the share of your power that will make me your successor," Elijah answered. And now you said, in the more traditional translation, it says a double portion. What's the double portion?
Of your spirit.
That's
what does that mean?
Birth.
The double portion is what goes to the eldest son.
Yeah.
That's considered to be the primary birthright.
The religious and financial responsibility.
So God obviously figures that Elisha is ready to take on responsibility. That's what we're trying to get to. So now Elisha is the head of the program. Elijah's gone up in the fiery chariot. And of course, Elisha catches his cloak coming down. He takes that cloak, rolls it up again, whacks the Jordan River, and it splits apart again.
Splits twice as much?
No, I didn't say twice as much. It splits apart. He walked across on dry ground. So, now, Naaman and his retinue, now that we've talked about Elisha, Naaman and his retinue show up wherever Elisha is. Do you think that was at the schools of the prophets?
Could be.
Wherever the king told them to go. Mm-hmm. To find Elisha.
And Elisha said, oh, come out, let me make a meal for you. Let's sit down and talk about this. Is that what happened? What did Elisha do?
Sent a servant.
He sent a servant out. Was that maybe one of the sons of the prophets? He sent a servant out, and what did he tell him?
Bathe in the Jordan 7 times.
Go dip in the Jordan 7 times and you'll be healed. Bye.
Yeah, I don't need to see you. Just go do it.
This is an over-the-phone prescription. I don't need to diagnose you.
Well, you can't imagine how many people I'm getting now in my practice that think that would be just great to get all their medical care over the telephone.
Well, it's almost like Naaman's getting the full power of the Lord that he wants, mm-hmm. but he's not getting shown respect, mm-hmm. you know. But yet the power is all there, but he's not getting the respect that he thinks he should have.
Yeah.
But by the position he's in.
Yeah. And what's his initial response?
Well, of course, because their rivers are better than what I'm looking at here. Why should I go here?
Yeah, we got better, much better rivers. This over at the base of Mount Hermon, coming down right off the snowy heights. Why should I dip in this muddy Jordan River?
So would this be like the President of the United States going to Britain and the Prime Minister and the Queen not meeting with him and saying, the Vice Secretary of Interior will see you?
Yeah.
Well, there's got to be a lesson in this.
What is the lesson? That's the next question.
Well, he obviously had some good men in his entourage, because they said if he'd have told you something more difficult, you wouldn't have thought twice. What have you got to lose? So he changed his mind in the end.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I mean, you know, think about it. Naaman, we've come all this way for you to get healed. The man hasn't asked you to pay anything. He hasn't asked you to do anything unusual. He just says, go. We have to cross the Jordan River anyway to get home. Go and dip in the river 7 times. What do you have to lose, right? Mm-hmm. And Naaman says, okay, I guess that's probably true.
I don't think he was that easily convinced.
You don't think he was that easily convinced? Why not?
It's just the way it's presented here in 2 mm-hmm. Kings. It just, he says, you know, he's upset. Mm-hmm. There are better rivers back home. You know, yeah. I'm not going to do this.
I agree with him. I agree with Gordon, because he's probably a man of pride, mm-hmm. of very, very big ego, very, very big pride.
Yeah. So what is he learning from this experience? First of all, the entire healing process was designed to demonstrate several things. One, that there was a true prophet, a real prophet of the true God in Israel. Two, that God rewards obedient compliance. Naaman had to swallow his pride after coming that long distance at the suggestion of a Hebrew slave girl. He had to listen to a foreign prophet, and finally to his own servants. But where else could he go for potential healing from leprosy? And so he went to the Jordan River and dipped in it 7 times. Now, my next question. What do you think he thought after he had dipped 6 times?
This is worthless.
This is it.
Yeah. Why did I agree to do this?
Well, but I mean, after all, you dip in a river, even if it's a little bit muddy, in and out 7 times, that's not a huge price to pay, is it?
I can tell you what he would have thought if he dipped down 7 times and nothing happened. I don't know what he did at the 6th time.
Yeah. Well, that's my question.
basically the lesson was he had to slow down and listen to what he was told, which for a man in his position was a little uncommon.
Yeah.
Doesn't it almost also show that this is how a common, ordinary person would be treated?
Mm-hmm.
You know, so that even a common, ordinary person can have the power of God for healing also. So in a way, it's kind of pointing that way. It's telling you something about how God does things.
Do you think that this experience of Naaman's was a little bit like a baptism?
I haven't been baptized seven times.
In a sense, because...
You know, that's too much. You're overdoing it, is what you're saying?
I think, in a sense, he finally had to realize there was another God that was more powerful than the whole cluster of gods he was used to.
Yeah, exactly. And when he came up out of the water that seventh time and he was healed, man, he must have been blown away.
Blown away that he went back and said thanks.
Yeah, that is quite amazing, isn't it? He went back and said thanks.
You wonder how long he'd had leprosy or whether he'd been able to hide it.
Yeah.
Because it's not always obvious from what I've heard and read. It takes time.
And then he had to use the number seven also, which is kind of a brand of God, mm-hmm. a certain God.
Well, he returned to Elisha with all his men and said, "Now I know that there is no God but the God of Israel. So please, sir, accept a gift from me." And Elisha answered, and apparently now, this time, Elisha comes out to talk to him. "By the living Lord whom I serve, I swear that I will not accept a gift." Why is that?
Seems like he always says that when he makes a decision. Decides on something.
God's healing power can't be purchased.
Yeah.
Okay.
But this is after the fact, so mm-hmm. a free will gift should be okay. Thank offering.
Yeah, thank offering. There were lots of there's lots of talk about thank offerings in the Old Testament. What's wrong with thank offering?
Not just in the Old Testament.
I mean, you're trying to run a bunch of schools of the prophets. What could you do with 6,000 gold pieces? Running the schools of the prophets.
Think what would have happened if he took the money. I think things would have changed a lot. As far as why they do things for God.
Yeah.
I mean, after a while, I mean, all that money, that would have helped the school of the prophets, right? They could have got a better building, maybe a new donkey, you know, all kinds of little things like that.
A whole bunch of donkeys, yeah. Well, so what are we supposed to learn through all this? Well, clearly, Naaman realizes that there is this God is way superior to anything he's ever heard about before, right?
Yeah.
Let's take a look at some verses in the New Testament. Look at Revelation 14:12. You all should be very familiar with this one. You should be able to quote this one by memory. This calls for endurance on the part of God's people, those who obey God's commandments and are faithful to Jesus. Okay? Let's look at 1 John 5, 2 and 3. This is how we know that we love God's children. It is by loving God and obeying His commands. For our love for God means that we obey His commands, and His commands are not too hard for us. So what are we seeing in these two passages? And then one more, Romans 6, 1. What should we say then? Should we continue to live in sin so that God's grace will increase? So what are we supposed to learn here?
God tells the truth.
Yeah, and He expects a humble willingness to listen. He expects compliance with what He says. He doesn't mess around. He doesn't just joke with people. If He tells you to do something, He intends for you to do it. Would that be another word for, people who really determined to do God's will, would they be called persistent, enduring? Of course, Revelation 12, verse 6 is talking about, verse 14, verse 12, sorry, is talking about what group of people?
God's people.
God's people? What time in history?
the end.
Could we be those people?
Hopefully.
Okay, so Naaman has been healed. He's gone back to Elisha. Elisha says, I'm not taking anything. What can we learn from that? Do we learn something about God by that? Well, there's several lessons I would like to suggest that we can learn from this. Naaman received something through the ministry of Elisha that he could not have obtained in any other way. Is salvation a little bit like that? Can't get it any other way. There's only one way to do that. So there's no way he could have bought it or earned it. Elisha refused the gifts that Naaman offered, suggesting also that salvation cannot be earned or bought. The fact that Naaman was willing to pay almost any price to get the needed healing suggests that we should be willing to sacrifice everything for the gift of salvation. Right? And I quote from Ellen White, this is the little book, Faith and Works, page 16, paragraph 2. Let this point be fully settled in every mind. If we accept Christ as a Redeemer, we must accept Him as a ruler. What does that mean?
Well, just as it says, He's called the King of Kings.
Mm-hmm.
It means you follow Him.
It means if He gives directions, He expects you to follow Him, right? We must accept Him as ruler. We cannot have the assurance and perfect confiding trust in Christ as our Savior until we acknowledge Him as our King and are obedient to His commandments. Thus we evidence our allegiance to God. We have then the genuine ring in our faith, for it is a working faith, it works by love.
Okay, just putting something together which you went over at the beginning.
Mm-hmm.
Jesus ordered the person who He healed from leprosy not to tell anyone,
mm-hmm.
and he didn't do it. So what kind of ruler is that where the guy doesn't following. So is he in trouble?
Well, I struggle with that question because I'm sure that Jesus knew what the guy was going to do.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that Jesus told him not to tell anybody because he realized or he knew that pretty soon everybody he healed went around telling everybody, guess what? I got healed by this man called Jesus. Pretty soon, Jesus would just be surrounded by people trying to get healing. He wouldn't be able to do anything.
Yeah, I know what you're saying there, but still, he did not follow the command of Jesus.
He didn't? Well, let's look at Jesus' example now. Knowing that it would upset his audience at his hometown of Nazareth, why do you think Jesus mentioned Naaman and the widow of Zarephath in his sermon? He didn't have to mention them. Remember the sermon? He goes home. This is after he's announced his ministry. He comes home for the first time. He's asked to preach. Everybody's excited because the hometown hero is here. So he gets up and he preaches. And what does he say? Well, let me just read the comments about it from Ellen White once again. Centuries after Naaman returned to his Syrian home, healed in body and converted in spirit, his wonderful faith was referred to and commended by the Savior as an object lesson for all who claim to serve God. So Jesus is commending who? Naaman for his faith, right? Think about what we know about the story of Naaman. Many lepers, quoting Jesus, many lepers were in Israel in the time of Elisha, the prophet, the Savior declared, and none of them were cleansed, saving Naaman the Syrian, Luke 4:27. God passed over the many lepers in Israel because of their unbelief, closed the door of good to them. A heathen nobleman who had been true to his convictions of right, so what does that mean?
He's honest.
Well, it means that he really believed that there was a possibility of getting healing. He followed the instructions that the girl told him to follow. He did what he knew how to do, right? Was in the sight of God, this person was in the sight of God more worthy of his blessing than were the afflicted in Israel who had slighted and despised their God-given privileges. God works for those who appreciate his favors and respond to the light given them from heaven. That's Prophets and Kings, page 252 and 253. Well, then Naaman has a very interesting speech that he gives to Elisha. What was his speech like? Let me read this. Verse 17. This is 2 Kings 5, verse 17. So Naaman said, "If you won't accept my gift," now he's really convinced that this God is different, right? "Then let me have 2 mule loads of earth to take home with me." Huh? He's got his bags full of gold and silver, and now he's asking for dirt? Why?
He wants to put it down and pray on it.
They believed in those days that each area of the world was assigned to a specific god. So if you want to worship that god, you have to go to his place. So Naaman is thinking in the back of his mind, says, "I can't come to Israel to worship this god that I now believe in. What am I going to do? I'll take some dirt from here and I'll put it in my backyard, and then I can worship Israel's god in Syria," right?
It's kind of like the Israelis making a can of rocks for an altar. It's a similar idea.
Yeah. "So I hope that the Lord will forgive me when I accompany my king to the temple of Rimmon." Rimmon is another name for Baal, the god of Syria, "and worship him. Surely the Lord will forgive me."
Oh, no. Certainly not. How can that be?
Yeah.
Who is him?
Okay. Here's Elisha. Naaman comes to Elisha, yeah, and he says, "Please accept these gifts. I'm healed. I'm so happy. Whatever you ask, I'll give you." And Elisha says, "I refuse to take anything." Mm-hmm. Okay. And Naaman says, "Man, I'm just blown away. I've never heard of a god like this before." Well, he says, "Let me do this because I want to worship this god. So let me take two donkey loads of dirt back with me so I can worship this god." Oh, but there's a problem. What's the problem?
I'm going to have to go worship Baal.
I'm expected to go with the king when he worships Baal. Should Elisha have said, "Nope, unheal him, give me his leprosy back"? What did Elisha say?
He accepted baby steps.
"Go in peace." And Naaman left.
So, it's that, the way you put it, it sounds like he was going to make a little plot,
yeah,
where the temple is, so that as long as he's on the plot, he's really worshiping God instead of Baal.
Right. So, well, not a plot. He's not making a little plot in the temple of Baal. He's making a little plot in his backyard,
or maybe in his home,
or in his home maybe. But sometimes he has, because he's the general, he's the head general. Sometimes the king says, "I want you to come with me to worship my god, which used to be Naaman's god, Rimmon or Baal." And Naaman is saying to Elijah, "You think it's all right if I go to the temple of Baal with the king when he wants me to accompany him?" And what does Elisha say? "Go in peace."
Peace, yeah.
It's kind of like... kind of like Paul when he says, "Don't worry about that stuff, they're nothing anyway."
Those gods are nothing anyway.
Yeah, they're nothing anyway. So,
well,
good analogy.
What happens when we try to win people to the gospel? Should we say to them, "Okay, we're laying down a line here. You either become completely a Christian, sincerely a Seventh-day Adventist, or not at all"? Should we do that?
You mean get completely converted, you do everything, all your habits, everything, all your thinking, all the way that you look at things, all has to change, and then you can become converted.
And let me give a very poignant example of this. If you become, it used to be thought, not so much anymore, but it used to be thought very, very sincerely, very seriously, in the Middle East, if you change from being a Muslim to being a Christian, you had to change your name, you had to leave your home, you had to leave everything. You had to completely change everything. You had to, like I said, you had to change your name. You could not no longer have a Muslim name, you had to have a Christian name.
Kind of like Muslims in this country go the other way.
So you're saying that God will let you ease into the water?
Well, I mean, that's the question.
Instead of jumping in.
What are we supposed to learn in this story?
I think the meaning I get out of it is if you're bringing, in common language today, if you're studying with somebody and you know they've got a Christian background of some other kind, you don't hit them over the head with everything that you believe. You work with what they've got and build on it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Well, it's kind of also saying that God isn't really exacting.
Yeah. He's considered. He recognizes where we've come from. He recognizes the steps that we take, and he appreciates the step. Mm-hmm. Basically, that's a really important point, because what's going to happen to the rest of us? All of us at this table, of course, know everything we ever need to know about God, right?
Absolutely. You're right.
So what's going to happen for the rest of eternity? We're going to be learning more about God.
Not me. I got everything all figured out.
See? So what are we saying? We're really saying all of us are on the path to heaven. If we're Christians, we're really trying. But we're still all on the path. Some may be a little ahead of some other people, but that doesn't matter. What really matters is the progress. Are we headed in the right direction? Right?
Yep.
Talking about the Middle East again. Believe it or not, when in the early days of Adventism in the Middle East, there were churches, and you can understand that there were already Orthodox Christians there, and there are Muslims there, and you understand the feelings between them even in those days. Adventist churches, big sign, no Muslims allowed. Is that the right approach?
Well, if you're scared of being corrupted. but we're not scared, are we?
I hope
because
not.
We have the Lord.
But would it be that if they encouraged Muslims to come, then they wouldn't be there anymore?
Well, a good question about, you know, but basically, you know, it was if they encouraged Muslims, basically, probably the scientists put up there for the benefit of Muslims, saying, we're not fighting you. We're not trying to, I mean, we may quietly evangelize Muslims and hope they slip in the back door, but not letting anybody know, because if they publicized the fact that they were trying to convert Muslims, they'd be in trouble.
So was that it, or was it that you had to convert from being a Muslim to a Christian to come in the door?
Well, and that's possible too.
Well, I don't know the intent.
Mm-hmm. Well, it could be from the outside. It looks like we don't want you, but on the inside, we do want you.
That's also possible. Well, the widow of Sarepta, or Zarephath, and Naaman the Syrian, I'm reading now from Ellen White, this is Acts of the Apostles, page 416, paragraph 3, had lived up to all the light they had. Hence, they were accounted more righteous than God's chosen people who had backslidden from him and had sacrificed principle to convenience and worldly honor. What does that say to you?
Worldly honor.
Do you think Naaman was healed because of his faith or because of his works?
He followed instructions, didn't he?
I think this...
Yes.
Aspects of both.
Yes.
Yes. Okay. It is clear that even if he had believed the words of the young Hebrew slave girl, staying at home and asking for healing would almost certainly not have accomplished anything. Would you call his trip to visit Elisha and dipping in the Jordan River a kind of works? Might seem like it, huh?
Well, it depends what you're looking at. Because, sure, walking out there, we can do that anytime. We can dip in water and everything. But what can we do to heal the leprosy? I mean, there's no works we can really do that.
Well, and here we have an example of something else that's unusual. trying to witness across cultural and linguistic barriers. That's always a challenge. When you attempt to do that, is our life example more important than our words? How do you think Naaman's family treated the Hebrew slave girl after he returned home?
Very well, I would think.
You would think they must have treated her very well. Well, consider the story of Jesus and the Samaritan woman as recorded in John 4, and Jesus and the demon-possessed man or men, you remember the 2,000 demons that were cast out and went into the pigs, as recorded in Matthew 8, Mark 5, and Luke 8. As far as we know, these were the first Samaritan and first Gentile missionaries. What was their message? Let me tell you about what Jesus did for me. Right? Mm-hmm. That's all they had to say.
That's all they could say.
They weren't trained theologians, what?
That's all they had to say.
That's all they needed to say.
That's all they could
say. So what do we learn from these passages, these stories? Here's a young girl who witnessed under very difficult circumstances, potentially, you know, if something had not worked out, they might have come back and punished her. And then there was Gehazi. What do we don't have very long time. Remember, Gehazi was Elisha's servant who went rushing after.
Yeah.
Naaman said, yeah, please, you know, made up a story, and he took some gold and he took some fine clothes. And what happened? He ended up with the leprosy, didn't he?
Yeah.
And his descendants, it's according to the story.
Well, do we have personal experiences that might help to spread the gospel? Are we afraid to share our personal experiences?
I think we often do.
There are many examples in the Bible of how God sought to reach out to groups outside of Israel, and the Israelites were very resistant. How are we resistant to reaching out to our neighbors and our fellow workers and our friends? Well, I'm not really comfortable. How good are we at spreading the gospel to those around us? Could we do something like this little Hebrew girl said, "Let me tell you about the only healer who exists." Our kind and loving Father, we thank you for being with us through this lesson, learning about this story and some of the implications of the story. We thank you for the many such stories we have in the Old Testament, what they can teach us about you, for Jesus' sake. Amen.